Hallelujah. Bless you, bless you, bless you.
From the moment that I wake till I lay my head, oh, I
hello, 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 hello. Hello. Just give me a wave. Hello, hello, hello. See my face. Oh God. Hello, hello, Stephen. God bless you. God bless you. Let's share into to our stories. Share to your stories. Share on your page. Share on your WhatsApp, and let somebody be blessed. This. Where is the party? I know. For those of you that are joining first time today, it is my birthday. God bless you, Sha Isabel. God bless you for joining. Brother Steve, you're coming with Alice. I can't wait to see you guys. Oh, you know, as you're growing, birthdays, you are thankful, but you're like, you take things cool. You take things cool. Yes, I think the light is better. Yeah, God bless you. Hi, Sha Isabel. God bless you for joining. Where are you watching from? God bless you, Bazak. God bless you for joining. God bless you. God bless you. Share to your stories. Share. And let's make heaven proud this evening. Let's make heaven proud this evening. I am excited. I am supercharged. The work of God must go on. Yes, coming with Alice, I know. Hephzibah Frances, God bless you, mighty woman of God, my guest. I am excited. Oh, Timpurity. Timpurity, joining. Timpurity, we are live, joining. Let's wait for a few people to come. But before people come, how has your day been? How's the week going? God bless you, Francesca. Hey, God bless you. Good to see you. Seska, God bless you. It's always nice to see you on here and your support. I'll see you guys soon. God bless you. How's the family? How is the family, everyone? How is the family doing? What's been the highlights? What's been the highlight of your day so far? I know the day has not ended, but what has been your highlight? Thank you. If you don't know, it is my birthday today. Yeah, I'm like a big kid when it comes to birthday. My husband is always like, oh, birthday, you need to calm down. You know, but we don't take a year lightly. You know, we don't take a year lightly at all. When God adds another year to your age, you need to embrace it. You need to be excited. You need to be thankful that you've made it to another year. Honestly, it's just amazing. And when it comes to my birthday, I get excited, not because, you know, I'm vain, no, but because I'm so grateful that I am alive, that I've seen a day like this. And so I get excited. I get really, really excited. And I've been playing this song, Goodness of the Lord, on repeat. Because the Lord has been good. The Lord has been so gracious to myself, to you. You know, it has been by the grace of God that we are alive. God bless you, man of God, Pastor Odro Boatin. God bless you for watching all the way from Ghana. God bless you. Tell me where you're watching from. Tell me where you're watching from. Tell me where you're watching from. God bless you. Whilst we wait for a few people, oh, it's going to be excited. I can't wait. I just can't wait for what God is about to do. You know, God bless you, Justine Amber. God bless you. You took me out today. I really appreciate you. Thank you. God bless you, Lorena Baduri. God bless you. Good evening. God bless you. Thank you, Flojo 292. God bless you for always joining. God bless you, Ade HSH. God bless you. So let's share. How has your day been? How's your week been? How is it going? What has been one of the most challenging things that you're dealing with right now? What is some of the highlights, you know, of your day or of the week? Something that you want to share? You know, my week has been hectic. Obviously, the kids are back to school now, so it's been so hectic, so hectic. Going up and down. Today I woke up 5 a.m. We have our ministry. We have 5 a.m. prayers. I woke up 5 a.m. and I haven't slept since. I haven't slept since. You can see my eyes is red. I was like, oh my God, should I go live today? Should I cancel? What should I do? Should I postpone? You know, my flesh was speaking to me a lot. I was feeling sleepy, but I said, no, I need to overcome this flesh. Holy Spirit, help me. And here we are. God bless you, Skin Captain. God bless you for joining. Help me share. Let's share, let's share, let's share. Share to somebody, invite somebody. Blow the trumpet of purity. Blow the trumpet of holiness by sharing. Blow the trumpet of holiness by sharing to somebody. We need the message of purity. Whether we like it or not, we need it. Purity is important in our generation. And so we need it. So blow the trumpet. Blow the trumpet by sharing to somebody, by sending it to a friend, a sister, a brother, you know, and they will be blessed. Whether they are married, divorced, whether relationship is complicated, you know, send it to them, invite them. When you are inviting them, you are blowing the purity trumpet. You are blowing the purity trumpet. Thank you, Itzama. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. Thank you. God bless you. If you're ready, just type purity is possible. If you are ready, type purity is possible. Just purity is possible. Purity is possible. Type for me, purity is possible. That's right. God bless you. Purity is possible. It is possible. Holiness. To walk in holiness. It is possible. That's right. Purity is possible. Purity is possible. Purity is possible. Just be blessed by this song. It's one of my favorite songs. God bless you. Miss Bella. Bell Wallace, God bless you, my sister, my lovely sister, Sister Nobel. God bless you for joining. It's going to be wonderful. It's going to be amazing. These are the kind of messages that we need in our generation, in the body of Christ. You know, sex and celibacy. there's a misconception about it. So we're going to talk about it. Don't worry if today I'm just like, you know, it's like I can't talk. I am tired. My eyes is red. But the work of God must go on. God bless you. God bless you. Be blessed by this song. Not this song. I was looking for yours. Yours. Wherever you are, I just want you to thank God. Thank God, thank God, thank God. Thank God, thank God. Thank God. Thank God, thank God, thank God. For being good to you, thank God. God bless you, God bless you. Join in, join the conversation, join the conversation. Join the conversation. Just begin to thank God, you know, wherever you are. Thank God for His goodness. I am so grateful that I am alive. I am grateful. I thank God for your life as well. You know, being alive, I always say it's a privilege, you know, to be alive. It is not a right. You know, it's a privilege. It's only the grace of God that we are alive. It's only by the mercies of God that we are alive. You know, it is nothing that we do that has kept us alive. It is just by the grace of God. The Bible says that bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name. So if you are alive, you know, I just want you to type, thank you, God, for the gift of life. 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 To be alive, it is by the grace of God. It is by the mercies of God. You know, even in our mess, God has kept us up to now. You have seen a day like this. As I'm talking to you right now, somebody might be in the hospital that they are fighting. They are fighting for their life in the hospital. So if you are here right now, I just want you, wherever you are, just thank God. That Father, I thank you that I am alive. I thank you for the gift of life. I give you all the glory. I give you all the adoration. It is only the grace of God. It is only the mercies of God that we are alive. Father, we are so grateful. We thank you for the gift of life. We thank you for who you are. We thank you, oh God. Had it not been you on our side, had it not been you on our side, where would we have been, oh God? Rabo sede gede bababa. Labra yandere bozeke telebayadaba. Labra kapayandere bede bede be. Rama mama 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 mama. Ikarabayada bababa. Rapayandere bede 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 be. Rebababa. Ba-ba-ba-ba-ba, yandara-ma-ma-ma-ma-ma-ma, rakapayandere-bere-bere-bere-be, rapayandara-ma-ma-ma-ma-ma, ikatala-bada-bada-bada-bada-ba, yandere-bere-bere-bere-bere-be, rapayandara-ma-ma-ma. Father Lord, we honor you this evening. Oh God, we thank you in the name of Jesus. Father Lord, we bless your holy name, oh God, in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you. Holy Spirit, take control. Holy Spirit, have your way, oh God. Breathe upon this life in the name of Jesus. Let your spirit, Father Lord, come upon this life in the name of Jesus. Father, breathe, oh God. Breathe upon this life in the mighty name of Jesus, oh God. Whoever is watching, Father Lord, whatever answers they are looking for, Father Lord, may they have that answer in the name of Jesus. Father Lord, whoever needs clarity, whoever, oh God, needs transformation, Father, may they be transformed by this life in the name of Jesus. Father, whoever, oh God, Father, needs awakening, Father, Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus, they shall receive awakening in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, anybody, oh God, that is in deep sleep, oh God, spiritually, let this life, Father, be a blessing. listen to them. Let it awake them in the name of Jesus. Let it awake them in the name of Jesus. Father, Lord, whoever is confused, Father, about their sexuality, Father, I pray and I declare that, Lord Jesus, they will receive clarity in the mighty name of Jesus. Whoever is struggling, Father, Lord, to find their identity, Father, through this life, let them receive, Father, Lord, their identity in the mighty name of Jesus. Let them discover, Father, Lord, their identity, Father, Lord, on this life in the name of Jesus, oh God. Father, Lord, we thank you. Whoever needs the mind to be renewed, those of us that needs the mind to be renewed, Father, Lord, as this broadcast, as we're about to start, oh God, as I'm about to invite the guests for tonight, Father, Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus, let the mind be renewed in the name of Jesus. Father, Lord, I thank you. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray in the name of Jesus. Very soon, I'm about to bring the woman of God onto the platform. I'm just excited, you know. These are some of the topics or some of the subjects that we do not get to talk about in our churches, in the body of Christ. Talking about purity is not popular. It's like a taboo. And so, for us to be here on this live and talk about it, it is only the grace of God and the mercies of God. There are seasons sometimes you're like, you know, forget it, you know, you're like, oh no, it's not popular, so let me just shut my mouth. But the word of the Lord is like fire in my bones, and I will not shut my mouth until it is preached, until the word of holiness, the message of purity, is preached across all nations in the name of Jesus. And it will take you and I to do it. It will take you and I to blow the trumpet. Hallelujah. So I'm about to bring the woman of God, Hephzibah. You know, it's going to be amazing. I just want to, you know, read about this woman of God a little bit. And you see, God bless you. God bless you. We are ready. Is your seatbelt on? Your seatbelt is on. We are ready. Amen. Amen. I just want to see if I can invite the woman of God now. Let me see if I can invite her to join me. Before she comes on, I just want to read a little about this woman of God, this mighty woman of God, all the way from Nigeria. And so I want to read just something brief about this mighty woman. Hephzibah's life story was one of lots and twists and turns, sexual addictions and abortions, before she met Christ and discovered a life of purpose in him. Now she is committed to raising young teenagers, youths, and awakening them to the truth that there is a better life in Christ Jesus. She strongly believes in the two-pronged message of purity and purpose, and that youths are made for more and do not need to go through the twists and turns she went through to find out this truth. This is amazing. They can be awakened to grow up to become purposeful youth who impact their nations positively with the light in them. So I don't want to give everything away. I'll give the woman of God the opportunity to introduce herself, to talk about, you know, her life. Woman of God, we welcome you. People of God, thank I just you. Want you to type, welcome woman of God, welcome thank woman you. Of God, all the way from thank Nigeria. Thank I thank God for your life, woman of God, thank for accepting you. Our invitation to come on and be a blessing. that you have always been, you know, to the nation of Africa and the world. And I'm excited. And please fasten your seatbelt. We are talking about sex and celibacy. This woman, let me just, woman of God, you are welcome to Purity Dose Talk.
Thank you.
You are welcome to Purity Dose Talk.
Thank you so much.
Well, God bless you. Can everybody hear the woman of God? Can everybody hear her, please? If you can hear her, just give us a wave. Just give us a wave. If you can hear her, just give us a wave. So God bless you, woman of God. Yes, they can hear you.
Thank you.
God bless you. Thank You're welcome.
Everyone. Thank you. I'm so glad. Amen. I'm honored and grateful to be here. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. Good evening. Wherever you are, if it's morning or afternoon, it's evening here. But thank you. I'm glad to be here.
Amen. 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 Mm-hmm. Now, we want to know, Hephzibah Frances. We want to know. I want to know more. I know you. I think we've been in touch for over 2 years. I think before the pandemic. Yes, over 2 years, nearly 3 years now. But we thank God for this opportunity. So we want to know, before Hephzibah became, is on a journey of celibacy and staying away from certain things, what is the story like? What was the story like? If you would like to share a bit of the story with us.
Okay. So, when you were reading my bio, I was a bit like, was that person me? Because I can't even, you know, when Jesus does something and it's almost like, it's like night and day difference. Like, I don't even remember that person. And his healing has been so complete that the only reason why I share my story, there's no pain, there's no scar, just a complete work that God has done. And it's just a testimony to his goodness. So my story started when I was really young, because I believe, you know, people have different things that brings them to Christ. For me, part of the enemy's strategy for me was lust and relationships. So there was a lot of set up even in my young years to bring me into this web where he thought I would never be free from. So as a young girl, I loved to read. I still love to read. And I loved reading stories. I loved reading novels. I just loved the arts, you know. And of course, I didn't know it at the time, but I'm a writer and I'm author today.
Yes.
So that was something that God had just put on the inside of me. But what happened was, since I didn't have a lot of guidance, I found myself reading every and anything. I was very curious. Here in Nigeria, we have like primary school, primary 4, and then primary 5 and primary 6. So while I was at primary 3 or primary 4, I was reading 3 classes ahead of me. I would read their English textbooks after finishing my own, because I just loved stories. So from reading English textbooks, of course, I started looking for the next thing to read, and then I graduated onto Mills and Boons. Basically, anything I could lay my hands on that was in story form or English form, I would read. And that was how I stumbled onto reading pornographic magazines from my elder brother. I was about 10 or 11 years old at the time. And I would read them voraciously. I didn't know it was a trap that the enemy was setting for me. And then very soon, I then entered into masturbation and started touching myself. Not that anybody taught me, but it was just like a natural progression. And I remember one day when my elder brother had caught me reading these magazines, and he had said, You are lucky you haven't started masturbating, because once you start masturbating, you won't be able to stop. Now, I wasn't born again at the time, though I'd grown up in a Christian home, but I didn't have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus. So I really wasn't concerned with what he had said. It wasn't, there was no consciousness of sin, you know, in me. For me then, the level of purity I had understanding for was, so long as I'm a virgin, I'm okay. And I was a virgin then, and I was trying everything to keep my virginity, but I was still into all this stuff. And then I went to an all-girls school. From there, I had scaled through. Nothing happened in my secondary school. The only thing was what was happening in my own personal life, which was the pornography and the masturbation. But there was nothing about boys or anything like that in my secondary school till I got to like SS2. That's like 2 years to graduation, 1 year to graduation. And then all of a sudden, a particular lady started writing me letters. They used to have these school friends, school mother something in secondary school then. And while I was younger, my parents had been divorced, and I didn't know it at the time, but I started suffering from wanting love from all the wrong places. Like, if anybody would have told me I love you then, I would have just jumped at it, because something was broken that I didn't even know was broken. And I had a lot of low self-esteem issues. You know, I didn't know if anyone loved me. And what just happened was, immediately she started doing that, I just fell, you know. And I was sick one day, really sick, almost delirious with fever. And she started touching me. They took me home. I came back from the hospital, and the lesbianism just continued from there. For a year till I graduated from...
I hope we are listening. Because this is deep stuff that you're sharing with us, and this is something that a lot of us are going through. A lot of people are going through what you have gone through. You said something that at the age of 10 you were watching, you know, you were reading pornography magazines, and then it graduated to masturbation. And then you made a statement that the fact that you were still a virgin does not mean that, you know, that is purity. You know, so that is really powerful.
I had already started dabbling into all this, even though I was still a virgin. And, you know, even in the whole lesbian story, I never allowed penetration or anything. Because I just had it at the back of my mind that my mom had told me, keep yourself. And I really intended to keep myself. I just did not have a right orientation of what purity meant. And about how it's deeper than, oh, don't penetrate me, don't penetrate me. I wouldn't even have known. And I didn't have like an internal regulation within me, because I wasn't born again. So I didn't have... an internal conviction on the inside of me. And when I get to when I became born again and how the change started happening, we understand more when I say like an internal conviction. Because today everybody says, some people argue that it's okay, you know, I'm born again, but I can do whatever I want with my body. But the truth is that if you have the Holy Spirit on the inside of you, and if your conscience is not seared, the Holy Spirit will tell you, this is not what your body was created for. Your body was not created for sexual immorality. So even outside the fact of anyone telling you this is wrong, there should be the Holy Spirit on the inside of you that regulates your conscience and regulates what you do.
That's,
you
know, right.
But I didn't have that at this time. So I proceeded to get into university. So lesbianism was like just 1 year. Nothing else happened after then. Even though like 10 years later, when I would begin to seek healing from the Lord, and I would begin to experience some deep stuff, because lust, When I come on to talk about lust, I talk about lust as a demon and not just as a social phenomenon. You know, there is a principality that sponsors sexual immorality.
Wow.
And it's called the demon of lust. And it's also the reason why we cannot overcome it by the flesh. The weapons of our warfare for overcoming sexual lust, pornography, masturbation, lesbianism, homosexuality, perversion is not a weapon of the flesh. It has to be by the Spirit of the Lord.
That's
because
right.
It is a spiritual battle. It's not a, you know. And so when people say, oh, I'm falling, I'm trying to just, you know, get yourself into condemnation and guilt, that's not the way to go, because your own power cannot do it.
That's right.
So, yeah, I got into university, and at this time I was still like, you know, I don't want to lose my virginity. So what would happen would be that, because I was looking for love in all the wrong places, I would have these guys that I would call up online, and then maybe we'll meet together. But I would tell them that, you know what, I'm a virgin, so I don't want to have any penetrative sex. You know, we can touch, we can smooch, whatever, but I was acting out stuff that I'd seen in the porn videos I'd watched, but I was just like, I don't want any penetration. So even my sexual orientation was not from the Word of God. It was from what I was getting from the world. And it's the same thing today. The world tries to sell you principles about sex. The world tries to sell you principles about sexuality, you know, and we, even if you're a Christian, if your mind is not yet renewed in that area, you know, you need to examine what you really believe about sex, what you really believe about sexuality, what you really believe about sexual pleasure. Is it what the Lord teaches? Is it what the Bible teaches? And the Bible says we pull down thoughts that do not, you know, that tries to exalt itself against the knowledge of Christ.
That's
and
right.
We replace it with the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. So God is the one who created sex. God is the one who created sexuality. So
that's
we
right.
need to constantly even check ourselves, even as Christians and as born again Christians, what is informing what we believe about this area.
That's
right. So I got into and started doing stuff that I had seen in porn, but my own principle and my own standard was, don't just penetrate me, I'm a virgin.
Oh my goodness. You see that the comments are not coming, because everybody is soaking in what you're saying. Because sometimes what baffles me about your story is that sometimes, you know, when you're addicted to pornography, you know, to all this sexual immorality, you feel like there's no way out.
Yeah.
There is no way out. And you said something. Yeah. You said that you kept telling the guys that don't penetrate, I'm still a virgin. So does it mean that, you know, if you're a virgin, that means that that's not purity? That's not, if you're doing other stuff and you are still a virgin.
If you're doing other stuff and you're still a virgin, that's not purity.
Wow.
If you are a virgin and you understand that I'm keeping my body for the Lord, and the Lord is not pleased with the fact that you're doing every other thing, and then he's applauding you because you're saying, don't penetrate me. That's not pleasing to him. He wants your whole body. He wants your entire, it's your entire body he wants on the altar. You know, and the Bible says, you know, it says, those who are shrewd, God will be shrewd to them. So that's like, in Nigeria, we'll say you have native wisdom. You want to eat your cake and have it. You know, you are telling God, you know, anyway, I'm going to keep this. But you're doing every other thing. You want to play on the edges and on the fringe of what you think is sin and what is not sin. That's not pleasing to God. God is not mocked. God is not a fool. You know. So I had to come. This is like further than my story, that I had to come to this place where, and the whole thing, I don't want to jump bars, but the whole thing that led to this conversation and conviction I had, where God said, it is the entirety of your body I want in purity unto me. Wow. You know, what had happened was someone was asking me out, and during one of our talks, I don't know how it happened, but I allowed him peck my forehead. And later on, I was on my way to a conference, and I could feel like the jealousy of the Lord over me. Mm. And the Lord saying to me that I have not given him permission to peck your forehead. And I was like, peck my forehead? You know, that people will say that's like, people will say nothing happened. But God was like, I could feel the jealousy of the Lord over me. I could feel him like saying that it is the one who I give permission to touch you, permission and access to your body, that I approve of, that I sanction. I didn't give this guy that permission, you know. And that would lead me to reading Romans 12 in the Amplified Version, where it says, I plead with you to offer your bodies unto God as a living sacrifice.
Right.
If you read this in the Amplified Version, it actually says, to offer all the members of our bodies to God.
That's right.
All members. Is your lip a part of the members? Yes.
Mm.
It was so, it gave it more depth to what God was saying to me, that it is every area of my body, not just one area that I think in purity, that it is actually every area.
That's right.
Know? So, if you are doing this in understanding and you are still a virgin, God be praised, you know. But if you are a virgin and you are trying to just get around, your father is not happy with what you are doing.
That is it. Your father in heaven is not happy, you know, a virgin or secondary virgin. And we think that, you know, we can just play with our body. God is a jealous God. And you said something, for you to feel the jealousy of God all over you, it takes the Spirit of God. It takes the Holy Spirit to actually be activated in you, for you to, you have to be so in tune with the Holy Spirit, so that when you are engaging in sexual immorality, you will feel that your father is crying over you. Your father is actually upset. Your father is actually jealous over you, because you said something that, you know, our body, the Bible says that all our members is unto the Lord. All our members belongs to the Lord. That means that our bodies, our eyes, our virginity, every part of you, it's important to the Lord. It concerns God. Now, woman of God, moving, like, to just push a bit forward. Now, celibacy. Somebody, you know, I mean, there might be a lot of us on this live where we've been there, we've done that, and now we are pursuing a life of celibacy. I want to ask the first question is, how long have you been celibate? And what is celibacy to you?
Okay, so I have been celibate, no sex, and no kissing anyone since the year 2012.
Wow.
So
wow.
What had happened was, you know, trying all the stuff with those guys, I actually ended up at a place where I had abortions. Wow. And at the time, you know, the enemy was lying to me, like, are you sure God will receive someone like you? You know, now take note that for me, I wasn't a bad girl. I didn't think I was a bad girl. I just felt like I had been caught up in, now that I think about it, like, Satan started his trap in my life really early. You know, so I didn't have any wisdom. I was very naive, you know. And then it just ended up as an abortion. And at this point in my life, I was less than 20 years old. And I discovered I had no joy. I didn't feel like I had a sense of purpose. I didn't even think I was brilliant. I was a very brilliant and intelligent girl. But I ended up at a point where I had zero self-esteem. The relationship I was in, it was all just a crazy time of my life. But my background, because my parents had raised me up in church, I wasn't born again, but my parents had, you know, every time, every Sunday we were in church, they had raised up with that God culture. So I did not struggle with the fact that God is real. And when I even think about it, I had a heart for God from a young age. I just wasn't born again. So at this time when these stuffs were going on in my life, I started to look upwards. I started to ask God questions. I started to say, is this the kind of life you have for me? Is this the kind of relationship you want me to be in? You know, is this really all there is to life? You know, is this the sex, the boyfriend, the is this it? You know, and I had an encounter with God where literally God had answered. He didn't answer in words, but I felt like the love arms of God. First time in my life, I felt the love arms of God so strongly. I didn't have a typical "Lord, I give my life to you" prayer, but the Lord just enveloped me in his love. Went back to my hostel in university, woke up the next morning, and I just woke up with a raving hunger for Jesus. Now, even after that salvation story, I still did not have a lot of wisdom. So I still fell into like sexual acts twice.
Wow.
That was in the year 2011. So at the beginning of year 2012, back to that internal recognition and conviction system I spoke about, when I would fall in these two episodes of sexual relationships, I would cry my heart out. I remember one of those incidents, like right there on the bed, the guy was just looking at me like, "What is wrong with you?" I was crying. I was crying because, and I think it is very important to say this, we should really be careful that our consciences are not seared, that we don't call okay what God is calling sin.
Wow.
If
repeat
your
that.
Heart
repeat that if, repeat that
we that. Must be careful that our consciences are not seared, that we don't call okay what God is calling sin. Our God is a loving father, but when you come into the life in Christ, if you're internal system of conscience regulated by the Holy Spirit is still alive, when you do these things, you should actually be happy that you still feel convicted by the Holy Spirit. Conviction is not condemnation. Conviction is the Holy Spirit saying, you are doing something that's hurting your father. This is not pleasing to the Lord, and I'm calling you to come back, redirect your steps, and come back to me. And really, that was what my celibacy journey was about.
Wow.
Beginning of the year 2012, when I found out that, hey, I'm born again, but I've still made mistakes. Okay, God, teach me what I do not know. This was my sincere prayer. If I can look for my journals from the year 2012, you know, you would see them. I was actually fasting and praying and saying to the Lord that, God, yes, I'm born again, but I'm still making this sexual mistakes, you know. I don't want to. I can feel your Holy Spirit on the inside of me telling me this isn't the right way. So I said, Lord, you know what? Help me, right? Give me grace. I'm going to stay off relationships. I'm going to stay off boys and stay off guys for this year. I thought it was going to be just a year.
Wow.
So I said, I'm going to stay off that, but teach me your way concerning relationships, concerning sex, concerning this area of life. Teach me your way. And that was the start of my celibacy journey.
Wow.
It was just a hunger that said, I don't know anything about this area. I keep making mistakes.
Yeah.
And I can feel your spirit telling me this is not the way. So, you know what, God, help me. Teach me your way. Give me grace.
That's right.
Help me.
That's right. So, God bless you, woman of God. God bless you. Yes, conviction is not condemnation. That is so powerful. You know, I think we need, you need to, some of us, we need to come back and watch this live again. You have to watch the replay when we finish it. Watch it several times, because the nuggets and the story that is being shared is not something that has been made or just cooked up. This is somebody's life that they have been there. For you to actually have that grace to focus on this journey of purity. I mean, weren't some times, maybe some days where you feel like you want to go back? Yeah. Well, were you like a strong macho woman even until now? Now you don't have any feelings. Because the reason why I'm asking these questions, sometimes when we are pursuing purity, you know, many of us feel like, oh my God, I shouldn't be having these sexual desires now. I shouldn't be, you know, feeling this type of way. And so I want you to explain whether, you know, as you're pursuing this journey of purity and celibacy, do you sometimes feel like, you know what, am I making mistakes? Do I need to go back? Do you get tempted? You know, does your mind play you? What would you say to somebody that might be on this journey and is feeling this way?
So the first thing I would say, thank you, Rev. The first thing I will say is, because of the way I started my celibacy journey, where it was just me really saying, God, I don't know anything about this area. Teach me your way. It was with a lot of humility, you know. It wasn't in strength. It was, I'm born again, but I keep making mistakes.
Wow.
So there's something that I personally am not doing right. I don't know how. So Holy Spirit, help me. Lord, help me. And and that posture has actually informed this almost 10 years celibacy journey.
Wow.
It has informed it. That posture of just saying, God, help me. Wow. I'm not strong. I fasted for this stuff.
Wow.
Literally. I added it to a fasting and prayer point. Because now that I think about it, the Holy Spirit just was burning a desire in me to please the Lord. I mean, I knew Jesus from, I didn't even think Jesus would have somebody who had blood on her hands from abortions.
Wow.
And then all of a sudden, he's pouring out his love upon me. You know, so there was something on the inside of me that said, who is this man? Who is this Jesus? I want to please you with my life. You know, when the Bible says we love him because he first loved us, you know, so if you love someone and you see what they've done for you, there's just this, like, I can't be doing this to you, Lord. That's Jesus, right. You know, so help me. I really want to please you. So first of all, it was just a God desire that was like, I want to please you, Lord. I wasn't doing it for man. I wasn't doing it for anybody. I never thought that almost 10 years down the line, I'll be doing an Instagram live. It was just a sincere, you know, heart to heart. I want to please you with my life. So help me. So I'll say that's the first thing. The help, the cry for help. And that brought grace.
That's right.
The cry for help brought grace.
Amen.
So that was the first thing. The second thing was, as I would go on my celibacy journey, like I said, my conviction for doing it changed. It wasn't because of they preached it in church even. That's the reason why, no matter what the world says, by the grace of God, I know what God has asked. I know what God is saying about purity. And we're not going back in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So it became a desire to please the Lord.
Mm.
It became, after the incidents when I felt the love of God, you know, the jealousy of the Lord on that whole pecking issue, I really just felt like he loves me so much.
Yes.
You know, he loves me so much. I literally felt like if I fall into sexual sin, Jesus would actually cry. I don't know how many of us may have felt this, but if God opens up his heart for you, and if you've come into a place where you feel the compassion of the Lord, you know, depending on the burdens that you carry, some of you may feel the compassion of the Lord for children on the streets, you know, you feel the compassion of the Lord for orphans, or you feel the compassion of the Lord for women, depending on the ministry he has called you to. Now, if you would feel the compassion and the heart of the Lord towards you, and if you would feel what he feels when you are on that bed with someone else, when he's your husband, the Lord is your husband. He's the one who owns you. You belong to him.
That's right.
And you are doing something that does not please him. Jesus is not, it's not really about the, it's not a condemnation thing. It's just, right. If you could feel that pain in his heart that says that,
yes,
I don't have the words for it. Yeah. I did not want the Lord to feel that over me. I did not want that. I didn't want the Lord to cry over me.
That's right.
I didn't want him to cry over what I'm doing. You know, so it, the second help was a change in my mindset.
That's
and
right.
My conviction about this. It became a love relationship with the Lord. It became a love. It wasn't rules.
Wow.
It wasn't a set of rules. It wasn't do's and don'ts. It was God brought me to this place where I knew that the Lord Jesus loves me.
That's right.
And I knew that the Lord Jesus is my husband. And I knew that I am married to him.
That's right.
And I knew that the one I'm married to won't be happy with someone else on the bed. That is not his chosen man in marriage for me. I said, God, I can't do this. It would, what hurts you would hurt me. What hurts you? Like, I would literally, you know, I'd done that the first year where I was literally crying because that's pain, like, really. And I pray that, you know, for some of us here, that you would feel the love of the Lord over you.
Amen.
You would feel his love.
Amen.
You would know that he loves you.
That's right.
You know, the love of God wrecks it.
It's unexplainable.
It's unexplainable.
You know, when you feel the love of Christ, when you understand the depths of the love of Christ over your life, it will stop you from doing certain things that you know your father doesn't love.
You know,
you said
and
something.
You know,
go on.
There are some persons that I've listened to their stories. Some of them about how the Lord helped them not to break their conviction. And I remember reading someone's story who said, I don't know if it was fiction or real life, but I'd read where he said, you know, he was almost getting into it, and he saw a picture of the Lord Jesus' face.
Wow.
And he was just like, I can't do this. I cannot do this. I can't. Because when you see Jesus, and this is not always like seeing him physically, but when you come into that place of a real relationship with him, where his love is washing over you, where you understand that this person has paid the price for me, like he has done everything to make me his, I can't throw back his sacrifice on his face like this. I can't.
Wow.
I just can't. You know, so his love is what then brings you to that place of, I have to please him. I want. People call me God's errand girl. You know, I lead ministries and I don't mind going anywhere for the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Not because he's asking me to as a matter of rules. But you know, when Jesus says the one who loves, who is forgiven much, loves much, you know, I just know he loves me so much that he has done so much for me. So there is a response that comes out of me that says, okay, whatever you want, you love me. Yes. You love me, you know, and maybe for some of you who are like in marital relationships where you can, you know, your husband loves you.